Hello, thank you for joining us today. Before we start, there will be a few technical guidelines. This webinar will last approximately 30 minutes, followed by questions and answers session at the end. You will be kept on mute, but you can submit your questions in writing using the questions and answers box. If you are not able to address your question during the webinar, we will answer you by email. Before we start, let me start our webinar with a brief introduction of our firm. CMS Russia is a full-service law firm advising clients on a wide range of Russian legal issues. We have good experience in dealing with compliance investigations, recovering damage from the employees, dismissing employees who are in breach of compliance rules, and prosecuting them through Russian law enforcement agencies in court. In Russia, we have more than 50 lawyers working for you.
So let's start with some general issues on internal investigations in Russia. First of all, we do not have any statutory regulations on this issue, so procedure, terms, time frames, rights of participants, they are not defined by law. What you can do, you can approve your internal policy dealing with this issue. It will help you to have some defined procedure, and also employees, when they see that there is a policy on internal investigations, they feel that themselves protected, because in the policy you can define any rules, for example, no retaliation and other protection for whistleblowers. Internal investigation, you can check any compliance related to work issues. In our practice, the most common claims are related to improper behavior of other employees or of managers. For example, employees often say that they are being discriminated or they are not being paid bonuses without any grounds, or their work is evaluated in an unfair manner. Another common situation is claims related to general legal practices. For example, employees could inform you about fraud cases or certain corruption practices at your Russian local subsidiary. Cases related to harassment, they are very rare in Russia, I would say. We faced such a situation only twice, I think, so it's not a very popular topic for claims from employees at the moment.
Any compliance investigation starts...
Oh, sorry. We divided our presentation into stages. They go like logically as the investigation goes. First of all, we will tell you how to prepare the investigation, then how to conduct it, what you need to do to formalize results, and which actions you can take in order to, well, after, in order to discipline employee, for example, after you finish your investigation.
Okay, we switch to the first stage. Any compliance investigation usually starts based on information received from the whistleblower by the company. Such information may be in the form of hotline complaint, which is something quite usual for a global multinational company, as we understand. But for Russian companies, to tell the truth, hotlines is still something not very common. In Russia, the complaint is usually filed by the employee in the form of personal letter addressed by the addressed to the compliance officer, or maybe CEO of the local company, or maybe even the global CEO. What should you do when you receive such a letter or complaint from the whistleblower? First of all, define the scope and the plan of investigation. What are the questions that should be addressed by you? Identify what exactly the complaint is about. Who is the target? Who may be questioned as witnesses during compliance investigation? Who should be in the investigation team? Should the investigation be dealt internally by your local team, or do you want to engage an external lawyer? If the investigation is dealt internally, we usually advise to comply the investigation committee of HR compliant, and aware. Second, usually when you identify where the documents or the information related to important for your investigation may be, you need to protect the information. You should immediately make copies of all the information containing in the employee's mailbox. If it is not possible, you may simply take away the notebook of the employee. However, please note that in Russia, the employee should be provided with equipment for performing his or her job duties. That's why if you take the computer away from the employee, you should immediately give him the substitute computer. After that, you should issue an HR order to formalize the investigation, because Russia is quite a formal country and every step should be formalized, especially if you want to use the results of investigation later on. Third, we usually recommend review the internal policies of the employer. The case is you need to confirm the violation that something that is written in the compliance complaint is really a violation of the internal policy. Another important point, most restrictions which are contained in global policies may not be enforceable in Russia. For example, the most popular question we receive from our clients on whether the non-compete provisions or non-solicitation provisions are enforceable in Russia. So the answer is no. So basically, even if the employee violates your own internal policy prohibiting non-compete behavior, it may not be enforced in Russia, unfortunately. Therefore, before starting the compliance investigation, you need to check policy. You need to engage your local lawyers where possible, just to understand in advance what potential outcome of the compliance investigation may be. Also, you need to analyze restrictions related to privacy. For example, in Russia, it is prohibited by law to collect information about person's private life, family, state of health, etc., etc. It may entail even a criminal liability. Therefore, when you review the employee's corporate mailbox, you should skip correspondence or documents related to employee's private life. At the same time, it is assumed that the employee's corporate mail should be used for business purposes only. Therefore, there should be no private emails. Nevertheless, if you see those private emails, you should skip them and not to use them during for compliance investigation. And last, before reviewing corporate mailbox or computer, you need to obtain from the employee personal data consent. Why? Because data you receive during the compliance investigation may be transferred by you from Russia to the group companies abroad, which is not direct employers of the employee. You can transfer such information to external lawyers. For all these actions, you need to get a personal data consent. And very quickly on don'ts, based on our practice, do not disclose scope of the compliance investigation before interviews. Certainly, it will help you to get more accurate information from the employee. However, the best practice and our recommendation would be, if possible, do not disclose at any stage to the employees you interview who is the target. And who is the whistleblower also, because employees may be friends, may be enemies with the whistleblower or the target, and obviously it may affect the objectivity of your compliance investigation.
So when you complete the first preparatory step, then you can proceed with reviewing mailbox of employee and other IT equipment. Of course, you can review everything that is stored on corporate equipment, such as mailbox, browser history, all data contained on servers, and so on, in on corporate phone. As Valeriy already mentioned, you should not review any private equipment, for example, private mailbox or private phone. This is simply illegal. If there, you would like to, if you see that there are some files which are private, then you need to check your policy, if it's internal policy, if you have policy that prohibits using corporate equipment for private purposes, then you can review all files because all of them are considered to be corporate information. If you don't have such policy, you can cover this issue with separate consent from employee, in which employee should state that he agrees that all information contained on corporate equipment is corporate and there are no private files. But this second option is less preferable, so it is better to have a strict policy prohibiting use of corporate equipment in personal purposes. Also, we recommend to use special software that allow you to conduct check quickly. In such software, you can put keywords by which it will perform search. And this simplifies and speed up check significantly. If you don't have such software available with your global compliance department, you can apply to third-party providers which can help you with this software.
Okay, execution stage, interviews. What are do's and don'ts based on our practice? Do, where possible, schedule interviews out of office, split times of the interviews. Why? We do understand that it will cause additional costs on the side of the company because you need to rent places for quite a long time. However, this will for sure help you minimizing the risk of employees talking to each other. In that circumstances, you'll get more objective information, which is quite important in the, for the compliance investigation. A couple of questions from our clients. Can the employee refuse to participate in the interview? Or if the employee participates, can he or she refuse to answer your questions? Unfortunately, the answer to both questions is yes. There is no legal obligation for the employee to participate in such interview or to answer your question. Therefore, it is quite important and we usually recommend it to our clients to have some kind of compliance policy or compliance provisions regulating an investigation in your code of conduct, for example, where the integrity provisions that the employee should report honestly and should answer all your questions and appear for the interviews should be included. In such case, at least you don't get legal protection by law, but you will be able to discipline those employees if they refuse to appear for the interview or they provide you or they refuse to provide you with any information. In respect to informing employees about the purpose of an investigation, there are two strategies. You do not inform. The obvious advantage of this option, you will likely get more objective information. However, your interview session will be more likely like question and answer, and you need to get your homework well prepared in advance because the list of questions should be very, very extensive. The other option, you should inform the employee about the purpose of the investigation. In such case, you will get a lot more information for sure. You will simply be asking the employee one question and you get answers on three additional questions. So he or she will be informing you even on those facts which you are not asking them directly. In our practice, we prefer this approach because we get more information. Do make notes of the interview and provide employees with such notes in paper form against signature. It is not always done, we understand that, but this is the best practice recommendation. A written notice signed by the employee may later be used by the company for formal disciplinary purposes. Also, employee will be unlikely to change his or her testimony given at the interview saying that he was simply misunderstood by the company. do record interviews where possible. We are talking about video and audio recording. This is basically for same reasons as stated above. You can use it later on, and the employee will be unlikely to change his testimony later on. But note that you need consent from the employee for such video or audio recording. And obviously, be careful what you are saying at the interview. If you, during the interview, tell the employee something that you should not be saying, then this can be used against you later on in court, for example. In our practice, targeted employees very often are pushed for getting out of the company. For example, they are told by the company that they will likely be terminated based on disciplinary grounds. When the compliance investigation ends, it is extremely difficult under Russian law to directly and immediately terminate the person, the employee, for the compliance violation. That's why many companies are using different approaches. Most of them use mutual agreement. However, if the mutual agreement is not reached, there is a redundancy option available. And now you can imagine if during the interview you were talking about termination for disciplinary purposes and then you switch to redundancy. Obviously, employee may challenge the redundancy in court using the recordings from the interview.
So, when it comes to formalizing results of investigation, you need to decide first if you would like to use them in order to impose any disciplinary sanction on employee or terminate employee. As we have very formalistic approach to disciplinary measures, if you would like to impose disciplinary sanction, then you need to formalize results of investigation properly. First of all, you need to prepare Russian language protocol on final results of investigation. It could be bilingual, for example, Russian-English version, but Russian language is a must. You need to have it. Also, investigation commission that you created at the first step should sign this, this protocol formalizing results. And all data that you collected during investigation, for example, this protocol, notes of investigators, all interview recordings on information that you find in the mailbox, this all should be stored in somewhere in safe place, because if the case comes to court, you will need to provide all this evidence in order to support disciplinary measures that you imposed on employee, especially if employee was dismissed. You will have to prove that you had grounds for that. Don'ts in formalizing results are related mostly to keeping results confidential, at least for a while, because until you decide what to do with the results of investigation, it's better not to spoil them and not to get employees, especially targeted employees, to know what was found, because you need to have some time in order to decide whether to take disciplinary measures or not.
Okay, when the investigation is completed, the company faces one of the two possible outcomes. First, if the complaint was not confirmed, then the company, in our practice, usually is trying to understand whether the complaint was caused simply by misinterpretation of the facts by the whistleblower, or it could be deliberate action from the whistleblower trying to get some personal benefits from such investigation. If the company comes to a conclusion that the complaint was ungrounded and it was filed by the employee for his own purposes, for example, there might be a conflict with the company and he is trying to create additional troubles for the company, there might be some, the investigation, the complaint might be used by the employee as a protection measure if he or she is targeted for termination. Sometimes by filing such complaints, the employee is trying to put additional pressure on the company to get more money in case of his termination based on redundancy or mutual agreement, et cetera, et cetera. So there might be some personal reasons behind filing such complaint. So if the company comes to such a conclusion, then usually the clients immediately decide to terminate the whistleblower who filed ungrounded claim. And here they may face difficulty because under Russian law it is prohibited to to terminate a whistleblower based on ungrounded complaint. So you will have to use some other grounds for termination which are directly provided for by labor code. The ground for termination number one would be a mutual agreement. However, it is very likely that the whistleblower will ask for a lot of money and you will not always be prepared to pay that much. So that's why many of our clients use another ground, which is redundancy of the position. So at the same time, if the breach was not confirmed, then it is important to avoid potential similar breaches in future. And for this purpose, of course, you need to conduct compliance trainings in those areas identified in the report and develop policies in those areas. So another outcome, if the complaint was confirmed, may cause first disciplinary measures taken against the employee, including the dismissal, which is not easy, but Katya will talk about that a bit later. And in addition, you may file a criminal submission to initiate a criminal case against the target employees. For example, if the breach was qualified as a crime under Russian law, which could be, for example, bribe, commercial bribery, manipulating tenders, fraud, and other crimes.
So if you decide to impose disciplinary measures on employee upon results of investigation, you have three options. These are imposition of a warning or reprimand or dismissal. Reprimand and warning are more or less equal measures, but a warning is considered to be a lighter sanction. So if it is just a first violation, usually companies impose warning on employees. When you proceed with the disciplinary sanction, you need to very carefully comply with the procedure and deadlines, because if you do something wrong, then employee will have good chances to challenge and cancel this sanction in court. For example, you have only 1 month in order to impose sanctions after you reveal the violation. In addition, there is a limitation period for violations. For example, if you find something that happened 3 years ago, you will not be able to impose sanctions on employee on that, because the maximum term is 2 years and it applies only to cases and violations which you reveal during an audit. And some violations cannot be within 2 years term, and general term of 6 months will apply. Also, you can impose sanction only for violation of rules and requirements which are duly fixed and for duly implemented, for example, duly implemented internal policy. And by duly implemented, I mean that the policy is localized in Russia. It is translated into Russian language, approved by order of CEO or head of the branch here in Russia, and employees are acknowledged with it against signature. Very often we face cases when company has a global policy that is not implemented in Russia. It's just, for example, posted on a website or was emailed to employees here, and unfortunately you will not be able to impose any official sanction in Russia on employee for violating such policy. That is why please check if all important policies are localized, otherwise you will not be able to do anything with employee for violating such policies. Also, you need to evaluate if this violation was severe, was it really something bad, because if you impose, for example, a reprimand for some violation that judge considered not that gross, the judge may just cancel this disciplinary sanction should the employee applies to court. Especially, this is the case for disciplinary dismissal. In Russia, you can disciplinary dismiss employee either for a single gross violation of job duties or for a repeated violation of job duties. List of gross violations is included in the labor code. It's a closed list. And to our topic, we think that, for example, disclosure of a trade secret may apply. Other cases include, for example, coming to work under drug influence or alcohol influence or being absent from work. These cases are not usually not within internal investigation. Under a repeated violation, what is meant under it? It means that you can dismiss employee only for violations that occurred after you imposed first sanction on the employee. For example, if you find during your investigation 3 or 5 violations which happened in the past and you impose sanction on employee for them, but you cannot dismiss employee for such violation. You need first impose sanctions, then you should give employee chance and time to correct behavior, and only if employee commits another violation after the first one was sanction was imposed, then you can consider disciplinary dismissal. Disciplinary dismissals are almost always challenged by employees in court in Russia because the ground for dismissal is indicated in the employment record, and the employee will have troubles in finding a new job with such record, and that is why employees almost always go to court and try to challenge dismissal. So you should be very careful with the procedure, and you should comply with all deadlines and prepare all the documents related to dismissal.
On this slide, we put for you examples of the most common compliance violations which may serve as the reasons for initiating a criminal case against the employee who was found in breach. Number one, bribery. Bribery is giving a bribe to a state official. Depending on the amount of the bribe, the penalty for this may be up to 15 years in jail, plus a fine imposed on the bribe giver up to 70 times of the amount of the bribe. Interestingly, that intermediary, so if you have, for example, another employee who actually brings the money to the state official, intermediary will also be criminally liable up to 12 years in jail. There is no criminal liability in case the state official solicits bribe from the company or from the officer of the company. In such case, you need to report the bribe. There are special hotlines in each state authority at the moment, or you can report it to the prosecutor's office or to the police. So in such case, you will be relieved of the criminal liability. Please note that any gifts to state officials which are above 3,000 rubles, approximately, how much is that at the moment?
At the moment,
20 euro. They are prohibited by law. The state officials must report such gifts to their superiors. So that's why be careful if you decide to give any gifts to state officials. Gifts between commercial organizations are also prohibited, by the way. Commercial bribery is number two. Basically, it's almost the same like bribery. The difference is only in the commercial bribery case, you give or receive bribe from a commercial organization. For example, you want to conclude a contract with another company, and your officer, your manager goes to the CEO of another company, giving him money or some, monetary services or some expensive tickets to football, for example, etc., etc. So it might constitute commercial bribery, and the penalty is up to 12 years in jail. There is also a liability of a legal entity. There is no concept of criminal liability of the legal entity. However, the company may be administratively liable for its officer giving bribe to the commercial organization or to the state officer. And the liability, the fine, is quite severe. It could be up to 100 million rubles, which is 1.3 million euro approximately. Also, the same rule applies if the company, for example, during compliance investigation, identifies a bribe gave by its top manager to another company or to the state official. If the company reports such bribe to law enforcement agencies, it will be relieved of the liability. Another popular crime is a fraud. The penalty is up to 15 years in jail. Different schemes are used in our practice by company employees to get self-enrichment. Abuse of powers would be another popular crime. The difference between fraud and abuse of powers, in case of fraud, the employee, the manager, is trying to enrich himself or close relatives. In case of abuse of powers, he or she simply creates damage to the company, for example, concludes a legal contract with a third party, with a relative's company or friend's company, etc. And the last one is the restriction of competition. Here we are talking about cartel agreements or manipulating with prices, etc., etc. This is also quite popular violation lately. The penalty would be up to 6 years in jail. So if you find out that your managers commit those type of crimes as a result of compliance investigation, you identify those crimes, do not be afraid to report them. I understand that the reputation of the company may suffer. However, in Russia, we are taking those corruption and fraud cases quite seriously lately. So, and I can assure you that law enforcement agency will be very interested to get this information. And the rule that the company or the manager will be relieved if you report the identified bribe or commercial bribe or any other crime, this rule will work. So there is not much to be afraid of. Okay, so and before we go to Q&A session, I think we're already almost there. Let me briefly discuss some popular questions which we received from our clients lately. Question number one, garden leave. The question, can we put the employee on garden leave during compliance investigation? So the answer would be as follows. The company is not allowed to unilaterally put on garden leave during the time of investigation. However, there are some options which you can implement. Option number one, you can ask the employee to go on unpaid leave. If the employee agrees, you send him or her on unpaid leave. However, in practice, this option is used quite rarely because the employee suffers materially, he or she loses money, the salary. So option number two, you ask him or her to take paid leave. It is also a popular option. However, the paid leave will substitute the scheduled paid leave, which the employee should take later during summertime, for example. So that's why employees are not keen to change their summer holidays to the holidays during compliance investigation. So the most popular option would be to send employee to work from home or to do nothing and keep paying him or her. So most employees agree to this option. Whistleblower protection. Are whistleblowers protected by law in Russia? Unfortunately, no. There is nothing in Russian law protecting whistleblowers. That's why it is very important that whistleblower protection measures, rules, should be included into your code of conduct or compliance investigation policy. Okay. Okay, and the last two questions, they are quite easy. Do you need to inform trade union when you start, or other employees' representative body, when you start the investigation? The answer is simple, no. There are no such rules in Russia, so you can continue start the investigation anytime without any consultation. Do you need any approval from the governmental authorities? The answer is the same, no.
So now we can switch to questions and answers. Please, please put them in the Q&A section. So we have a couple of questions now, and we will answer them. So first question is that I will read it aloud and then answer this question. So you mentioned that the deadline for imposition of a disciplinary sanction is only 1 month, but usually the compliance investigations last much longer. How do we comply with the deadline in such case? Well, it's not, there is no straightforward answer to this question. For example, if compliance investigation is conducted at a global level and local management is informed on its results only when it is done by report, then 1 month period will start counting from the moment when local management received this report. But if employee files a compliant claim or informs local manager on something, then the limit, this 1 month term will start from the moment when local manager learned about violation. So you will have to do investigation really quickly in order to comply with this deadline.
Okay, here's the second question. What if the employee during the interview provides false information to the company? Can the employee be liable for this? Good question. Yeah, we discussed that the employee may refuse to participate in the interview or may refuse to give any information, answers during the interview. But what if he deliberately provides false information? Well, unfortunately, there is no statutory liability for doing this. The liability is only provided for if this employee, if the criminal case is opened and this employee receives the status of a witness, for example. So in such case, he or she will be criminally liable for providing false information. However, during compliance investigation, there is no statutory liability for this. That's why, as we discussed, it is very important that the compliance policy of the company includes such restrictions as to providing only true information during compliance investigation. If he violates this rule, you will be able to discipline this person, at least. There is also if this person provides false information about another employee of the company, such another employee may file a civil lawsuit to a Russian court and seek for damages, but not the company. Okay.
So we will answer. We received another question. What is the most common reason for companies to lose in a litigation or for dismissal following an investigation? Well, based on our practice, the most common grounds are violating procedure for dismissal, for example, not observing deadlines or forgetting to ask employee to provide written explanations or not giving employee required 2 days for providing such explanations. These are most common grounds. Another ground could be, for example, if you dismiss employee for violating some rule which was not properly fixed, for example, this some requirement known to employees, but it's not in the job description, not in the employment agreement, or in the policy that is implemented in Russia, then such a dismissal can be considered ungrounded. Or recently we see more and more cases when judges consider dismissals very carefully, and they analyze, for example, if employee had good behavior previously, worked for 20 years with no problems, and then committed a couple of violations, and you dismiss such employee, the judge may consider that this is too tough and that dismissal could be should be applied only for some really serious and gross violation. That is basically current practice on litigation on dismissal.
I just want to add that immediate dismissal for most of the violations which you identify during compliance investigation will not be possible for sure. In Russia, dismissal is allowed only in direct cases provided by the Russian Labor Court. So, some examples, the employee can be immediately terminated for unjustified absence from work for more than 4 hours during the day, for being drunk at work, etc., etc. However, your compliance investigation will likely to identify some other violations of your policies. For example, non-compete, non-solicitation, I don't know, maybe harassment, as we discussed. You will not be able to use those reasons for immediate dismissal. The only exception would be several top managers in the company, such as CEO of the local company. For him, you will be allowed to include those additional dismissal grounds into his contract. Another exception will be the head of your local rep office. He or she will be allowed to be terminated for a single gross violation of job duties, which arguably can be understood as violation of your internal policies, if the violation is severe enough.
We do not see any other questions in our Q&A section.
So we are perfect on timing, I guess, and thank you very much for attending our webinar today, and this is the end of our presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you.